Our text this morning is really just one verse, but I thought I would read the context of the verse, and I'd like to read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verses 1. Ooh, let's see, I forget exactly what I had set apart for the reading, but let's just read, we don't want to start in verse 1. Let's begin in verse, what is this? Okay. Sorry, having computer problems at the same time. Okay, attacks of the enemy. Well, let's begin in verse 12. Okay, for the first part of the chapter has to do with encouraging one another and the fact that the Lord is coming. And that certainly is a great encouragement to us. But we're still on earth. We still have things to do. So this is what Paul was exhorting the church in Thessalonica. He says in verse 12, "But we request of you, brethren, that you appreciate those who diligently labor among you and have charge over you in the Lord and give you instruction, and that you esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Live in peace with one another. We urge you, brethren, admonish the unruly, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with everyone. See that no one repays another with evil for evil, but always seek after that which is good for one another and for all people. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit, do not despise prophetic utterances, but examine everything carefully, hold fast to that which is good, abstain from every form of evil." Now let's go ahead and stop there. What I'd like to do is focus on the one phrase that's in verse 14. Actually, I think it probably qualifies as a clause. Encourage the faint-hearted. That's something that I can't recall ever having heard a sermon on, and I do think that this is one of the ways that Satan tries to attack us, and he tries to weaken us. He tries to get us to feel inadequate, and that's essentially what faint-hearted means. You realize you're not adequate. Well, we need to encourage one another in this regard to look to the Lord Jesus, particularly in view of the attacks that we have to endure of the enemy. Now, I just, by way of very quick review, because I don't want us to forget what it is we've seen that Satan is attacking us. He is attacking the standard of our Christianity. We saw he's trying to change the Word of God. He's trying to change our understanding of the Word of God. He's trying to really change our view of it, whether we, believe it's good or bad, whether it's authoritative or not. He wants to eliminate the standard and basically get us to live however we want to live, because if he does that, he knows he is going to make us ineffective. He also attacks the motives that we have for serving the Lord. Remember, he hides the glory of God in the creation. That's what the world is seeking to do, but our flesh does the same thing. He hides his beauty as it's revealed in the Word of God. He tries to call into question our relationship with the Lord, whether we actually know him or not, because he knows if we can become introspective, we'll be caught up in simply trying to settle the question, am I safe? Can I really go out and tell other people how to come to Jesus and be safe from hell if I'm still in danger? And of course, he also tries to tear down our devotion to God. I really don't have to love God the way he calls me to. So he also tries to erode our motive in serving the Lord. Now, last week we also saw that he attacks our love for our neighbor. Jesus tells us that we are to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. It's the second greatest commandment that is like the first, in that it is a commandment to love those who are in God's image. But we saw the problem is that our neighbor isn't always lovely. It's not always easy to love our neighbor. Now, it's easy to love the people of God because we have Christ being formed in us. We should be able to see something of Jesus in each one of us, and that is something that we can love. But unbelievers really aren't lovely, at least when it comes to morals. They may look outwardly nice, beautiful, handsome, but they're not inwardly beautiful because they have nothing of Jesus in them. They have nothing of God's moral image in them. They essentially share the same nature as the devil, who we do not find to be attractive. Now, our enemies are particularly unattractive to us, and that makes it even more difficult to do what our Lord calls us to do. So we noted that in loving our neighbor, we're not going to find our motivation necessarily in them, to love them in them, particularly as we focus on their flaws and on their sins and on their offenses and their ill will. As we do that, it engenders only hatred in our hearts, and we're not going to want to reach out to them. So we need to find our motive in another place. We need to find it in God. Let's not forget that God loved the world and he sent his Son. God loves the world today, and he loves it not because it's lovely, but he loves it because that's what he chooses to do. God is love. That is his nature. He has that love in himself, and that shouldn't surprise us because God has everything that he needs in himself. But we're called to do the same thing, and we don't have that love in ourselves. We need that love from him, and that's why he gives us his Holy Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love. John tells us that if we are born of God, we will love because we have his Spirit within us. We will love God, and so we will want to obey God who calls us to love our neighbor. And we will have that love that comes from God for our neighbor so that we will want to love them. One thing I wanted to make sure that was clear from last week is that the love with which we are to love our neighbor, even though what we see in them is not going to move us to want to do that, the love that we have for them is a real love. It is still an affection. You know, we're not saying that we just need to love our enemies by going through the motions of what love looks like, a kind of a formal love. When the Samaritan stopped to help the Jew, he felt compassion for his enemy. There was an affection, there was a feeling, his heart went out to him, but it wasn't because of who the man was. It was because of his predicament, his situation he was in. They're in a predicament as well, and our hearts need to go out to them. Now, there is affection, but that affection, as I've said, comes from God. We need to have compassion on others with the love that the Lord has given to us, the same kind of compassion that God showed us when we were his enemies. He loved us and sent his Son for us. Now, that was review. Today, we're going to consider two more attacks that perhaps are on a bit more of a personal level. That is an attack on our adequacy, whether we can really do what the Lord calls us to do, and an attack on our courage, the fear of what is going to happen to us if we do what the Lord calls us to do. Now, this morning, we're going to consider just the first one, and I want us to see that we are adequate. We can do this through the Lord Jesus. God can use us. God will use us if we are willing to trust him. Now, Paul says in our passage, as I've already pointed out, something that we don't often think about. He says that we should encourage the faint-hearted. But you know, the word faint-hearted, I'm not sure if it occurs more than just this one time in the Bible, and I'm not sure when we read it if we really understand what it means, because it really sounds like a character out of Pilgrim's Progress, doesn't it? As a matter of fact, I think he does have a character called faint-hearted, but it wasn't exactly the meaning behind what Paul is saying here, because he uses it as a villain, and Paul here is talking about believers. Okay, so what does it mean to be a faint-hearted believer? Well, the word itself literally means this: one who feels his resources are too small for a given situation, faint-hearted, despondent, and discouraged. Now, I think that definition and this concept is something that we are all familiar with, and I think we can all relate to it. I think we've all felt it at one time or another, from our own personal experience, that we are not up to the task of what Jesus has given us to do. We just aren't gifted enough. Now, not everybody has that problem, but I think the vast majority of Christians do have this problem. And we do need to ask this question, how does that happen? How do we get into this kind of a situation? Well, the first is by looking at ourselves rather than looking at Jesus. Just want to remind you what we read. In Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 through 23, the account of Peter as he was walking on the water. Remember, as long as Peter was looking at Jesus, he could do the impossible. But as soon as he took his eyes off of Jesus and he looked at the wind and the waves and the storm and the fact that he was standing on the water, when he looked at his own ability, or rather his own inability to walk on the water, he began to sink. Now, as long as we look at ourselves, as long as we look at our own abilities and our own, you know, gifts and resources, we're always going to come up short. We're always going to be faint-hearted. So that's one problem. We need to look to Jesus and not look to ourselves. But another reason is because of spiritual attack. Satan does not want us to believe that we can do what Jesus has called us to do. He knows that if we begin to believe that we can and find those resources in the Lord Jesus Christ, that we're going to step up to the plate and we are going to fight against him. And when we do that, he is going to lose something that currently belongs to him. In other words, souls are going to be freed from his kingdom. So he is going to do everything he can to defeat us before we begin. And he's going to do that by, first of all, showing us our faults and our weaknesses, that we fall short of what the Lord calls us to be. Now, his reasoning goes, you know, something like this. Hey, if you're going to represent Jesus, if you're going to be Christ to your neighbor, don't you need to be like Jesus before you do that? I mean, let's face it. You're not very much like him. Jesus wouldn't live the way you live. Your neighbors are not blind. They see your hypocrisy. You call yourself a Christian, but you're really doing the same thing the rest of the world is doing. You're not doing anything differently. You're living the way they live, talking the way they talk, desiring what the world desires. I mean, how are you any different than the world? That's not what Jesus wants. So you're going to give a bad testimony for Jesus. When you try to point a sin out in your neighbor's life, he's going to be pointing the finger back at you. When you try to tell him the gospel, you are going to do more harm than good. So he begins to erode our character. And, you know, let's face it, we're not perfect. Secondly, he's going to tell us that we don't know enough to tell somebody else the gospel. Hey, after you've considered what you're like, if you still want to give it a go, go ahead, but realize you are not going to be able to answer their objections. You are not going to be able to refute the atheist and prove that God exists. You're not going to be able to answer their evolutionary questions. You don't even know the gospel well enough to explain it to other people. So he'll try to work on your knowledge of the gospel. And then I think he will also try to persuade you that you're simply not persuasive enough. You don't have enough confidence in the truth of what it is you're bringing to your neighbor. You're not going to convince them. The whole thing sounds so silly that you don't even believe it yourself. And if you're not convinced, how are you going to convince other people that this is true? Now, have you ever heard anything like that? Have you ever thought anything like that? Have you ever felt that way? Well, again, it's the enemy's attack, and we all have to admit that Satan is at least partly right. When we do take a good look at ourselves, it can make us basically faint-hearted, like Paul tells us. These people exist, and we are often these people. So what is it that we should do? How can we overcome this attack? Well, Paul gives us the answer. We need to strengthen each other. We need to strengthen ourselves. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 14, encourage the faint-hearted. Now, that basic meaning of that word, encourage, means this: coming close to someone's side and speaking in a friendly manner, as rousing up someone's will about what ought to be done to encourage or to strengthen. or secondly, as rousing up hope for a good outcome of what has happened, comforts and consolation. We need to encourage one another, Paul says, in what ought to be done. Okay, what is it that ought to be done? Well, we ought not to be faint-hearted. We ought not to be those that are despairing about our ability to do what the Lord has called us to do, but rather, we should be encouraging one another to do what the Lord has called us to do with His resources. And what is it that He calls us to do? And as I read these things, think about this. The Lord does not call us to do anything that He doesn't at the same time give us the ability to do, right? Now, some of these things are perhaps larger. They're perhaps the grand things that we are to do as a church, but we can at least do our part. So what should we do? First of all, we are to be a light shining in the darkness. Jesus says in Matthew 5, verses 14 through 16, "You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." Do you know that you and I can do that because we already are light? Jesus doesn't say become light. Jesus says let your light shine. That's what we need to do. And we can do it because of what Jesus said. Now, secondly, we need to encourage to move the Great Commission forward. That's essentially what this last commandment had to do when he says shine, let your light shine. Why? Because there are people in darkness who need to see it, and they need to be rescued. That's a part of the Great Commission, Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." This is the grand rubric under which everything we do as Christians is under. We are all a part of it. Jesus has given us the command, and he has told us he will be with us to help us do it. He also says, as far as what ought to be done, what is the small part that we have to play in this? Well, certainly through our prayers, certainly through our giving, certainly through our encouragements, but also through our witness. Peter writes in 1 Peter 3:15, "Sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence." When you share the gospel with someone, they're inevitably going to ask you, "Why do you believe this? Why do you have hope in this? Why do you believe it's true?" And that's where you can bring your testimony to share as well. This is what Jesus did for me. This is how he transformed my life. This is how he guides me. This is what's happened and how he's transformed me and how he has blessed me and why I'm so happy. It's because of what Jesus has done. So we need to encourage one another in what it is we ought to do. And this is what we ought to do. Now, like the Samaritan, and not like the Jew, the priest and the Levite who passed by on the other side, but like the Samaritan, we need, I think, to stop counting on other people to do what our Lord calls us to do, and we need to do it ourselves. You know, the thing is, there's a lot of churches, there's a lot of activity that's going on to further the kingdom of heaven. We sometimes look at ourselves and our resources and we say, well, we're relatively small, there's not much we can do, so we'll just leave it for them. And we'll just continue to worship and kind of do what's comfortable for us. But we really can't have that kind of mindset. We need to encourage one another to do what the Lord has called us to do. We need to consider ourselves to be the only church that exists on earth. And if we die, the gospel dies with us. You see, if we thought along those lines, what would we do differently? But that's exactly what we need to do differently. Now, the problem is, again, do we have the ability to do this? Well, we need to encourage one another in the fact that we actually do have the ability to do this. I've already pointed out, Jesus has already made you light. So we need to shine that light. He's already given us the commission, and he said he will be with us. He has already made us to be that kind of influence that we need to be among those around us. But let's be encouraged by the meditation we looked at this morning, because it tells us that God will actually use us. Not just that he can, but that he will. And as a matter of fact, it sounds kind of strange to think of it in these terms, but we will accomplish the work that God sent us into the world to do. On a large scale, that's what Psalm 72 is about. The kingdom of heaven is going to spread to the whole earth. The church is going to accomplish that work. It's going to be done. Okay? But we, as individuals, are also going to accomplish the work that God sent us into the world to do. And we read about that in Ephesians 2, verse 10. Paul says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God," that is the good works, "God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them." Now here is the hope of our usefulness, and this isn't the only passage in Scripture, but I think it's one that's interesting and it's certainly clear. Our hope of being useful is not in and of ourselves. Again, if we look to ourselves, we're going to see that we're inadequate. Our abilities, our plans, our efforts, we cannot do what we need to do. Our hope is in God's ability and in his plan and in his work through us. Now, this text answers the question, why did God save us? Well, he saved us, of course, because he loved us. We often think about that, and that's wonderful. It's great. He saved us so he might glorify his grace, and that's wonderful. He took a wretch who was worthy of hell, and he gave his son and cleansed us from our sins, as the table reminds us, gave us his righteousness, and we're going to go to heaven, and God is going to put us on display forever as trophies of grace. This is what I have done by my grace, and he'll point to us. That's wonderful. But he also saved us because he had a work for us to do. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. Why? For good works. Basically, he saved us so that we might do something useful. That's what a good work is, something useful. Now, he has a plan for us, and he's going to carry that plan out, Paul says. These good works which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. What Paul is saying is that God essentially made each of us for a purpose. Now, the general purpose is that we should be like Jesus, you know, put on his character, that we should be his ambassadors of the gospel. That's generally. But he has also a more specific purpose for each one of us. We have a particular part of the work that each of us are supposed to do. And we don't know what it is in advance. When the Lord saves us, we have to kind of discover it as we go along. And we won't fully know what it is until we reach the end and our lives are basically over. Do you think that Martin Luther, when he came into the world, when he was saved by that clap of, you know, thunder and that lightning bolt, "St. Anne, I'll become a monk," and goes into the Augustinian monastery, do you think that he knew at that moment that he was going to begin a reformation and become a leading, you know, leader of that reformation, and that his life was going to affect the church for centuries to come? You see, Luther was just simply trying to be faithful, and that's what we need to do, is to try to be faithful at all times. We don't know what the Lord is going to do with us, but we do know he is going to use us. But again, we won't know the full extent of it until life is over, just like Luther didn't know. Nobody else knew except Jesus what the Lord was going to use him for. But we do know this. If we do belong to him, God did not save us and send us into the world on a fool's errand. Okay? Yes, we make a lot of mistakes. Yes, we fail. Sometimes we fail miserably. But the Lord knows that in advance. The Lord has included that in his plan, as well as everything else. In the end, through his Holy Spirit, we are still going to accomplish what it is that he made us to do. And that's a tremendous encouragement. You know, where I was growing up in San Diego, one of the trips we made down to San Diego, you know, the families, as we all grow older, we reach that point of death. There was a Christian family down the street. Hal Whitehead, a good friend throughout the years, and he and his wife are Christians, and their son and daughter, Tim, well, their son was a Christian, the daughter became a Christian later in life. She had to go through a lot of difficulties at first. But Hal would come down, and he was witnessing to my dad, my father, continuously, and I was very, very thankful for that. Well, one of the times we were down there, Hal was at a point where he was kind of losing a bit of his mind. He was in his 80s. He was dying. And he was looking back over his life. And he was thinking, you know, I really wish I had gone into the ministry. I really wish I had done more for the Lord. And he was just despondent over the fact that he had not done enough with his life. So I was thinking, well, all of us have shame, you know, from our past. We've all done things that we're not happy about. We've all made mistakes. We've all sinned and done things like that. But I also mentioned to him that he, in his life, had done precisely what the Lord had made him to do. Now, I could say that. He didn't believe the same way I did regarding God's sovereignty. But that's what God's sovereignty means. That doesn't mean that God made him do all the bad things. But it does mean that God enabled him to do the good things and that everything that he did was a part of God's plan. So I was able to encourage him, and I said, you know, Hal, you have done exactly what the Lord made you to do. And now that your life is over and he's taking you home, you can know that his work for you is over. And now you're going to enter into heaven. And he was very encouraged by that. And I think that can be an encouragement for us, particularly when the enemy comes against us, to try to tell us that we have ultimately, utterly failed, and we have failed in many ways. I'm not saying we haven't, but the Lord knew we were going to fail, okay? And he also knew what he was going to do about it. And he was going to use all these things for our good. He was going to work all of it together for good. So what should we do again when the enemy comes to us? There's several things we need to do. First of all, let's remember to get our eyes off of ourselves and get them on Jesus. Whatever his attack is, if it's against our sins, look to the Savior for his forgiveness. If it's our inadequacy, look to Jesus for his provision. Remember Peter. As long as you are looking at Jesus, you can do some things that are impossible to do. But if you're not looking to Jesus, you're going to sink. You cannot do it without him. Jesus says this in John chapter 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Do you see what Jesus says there? If you don't have Jesus, if you're not connected to Jesus by faith, if you're not trusting in Jesus, you cannot do anything to advance the kingdom of heaven. You cannot do anything that is pleasing to God. You cannot do what he commands you. But once you have trusted Jesus, because you're connected to the vine and you have his resources, there's really, in a certain sense, nothing you can't do, at least with regard to what the Lord has called you to do. Paul says in Philippians 4, verse 13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. I can't do it in myself, but I can do it through him. And then 2 Corinthians 3, verses 4 through 6. Listen to what Paul writes here. Such confidence we have through Christ toward God. Not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God, who also made us adequate as servants of a new covenant. His adequacy was not in himself. His adequacy came from the Lord Jesus. It came from God. Now, that doesn't mean that if we trust in Jesus and we're connected to him, that we are now unlimited. There are still certain things we cannot do, right? We cannot be as much as we might like to be as great a preacher as Spurgeon was. We cannot be as great an evangelist as George Whitefield. We cannot have the theological mind of a Jonathan Edwards, but we can do, for trusting in Jesus, we can do what God made us to do. And the point is, we should never let our enemy tell us otherwise. Look to Jesus There is strength and ability in him. God made you for a purpose, and he's going to fulfill it as you look to Jesus. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer, shall we? And let's ask the Lord to apply what we've heard.